Welcome to Cinemaholics. I'm John Negroni, film critic based out of San Francisco, California. We all know where San Francisco is. And we all know where Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania is, that's for sure. It's also Will Ashton on the microphone today. Hey, Will.
Hey. Yeah, two places that are pretty far from the focus of the film we're going to be discussing today.
No kidding. No kidding. But I like to think that as far as the film goes, which we'll get into, very, you know, odd couple sort of mentality that informs this podcast and the chemistry therein, I would say.
Sure. We are cousins in spirit.
Yes. There you go. Now, we are in the heat of award season. We have a lot of movies coming our way that we're trying to watch in anticipation for the end of the year and our thoughts on the year at large. I know a lot of folks who do listen to Cinemaholics regularly, or they try to, will probably be like, well, hold on. How many movies has John even seen this year? And the answer is not very many. But I'm trying to rectify that, Will. I've been catching up on a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I'm excited to catch up on a bunch of stuff. And I'm excited to do some more recordings with you, just because I feel like if we do a bunch, we're going to get very loopy and weird about some like high profile movies. So I think that could be fun.
I would say so. I would say so. And I love the end of the year, because this is the time when, even if you are watching movies throughout the year, a lot of the award season stuff, we don't have a chance to see until November, December, and what have you. And it usually is this kind of blitz, no pun intended for the movie, Blitz, the new Steve McQueen. But it's a bit of a blitz to try to like watch everything on time, and it can be a little tricky. But we do have a movie here that we both have seen quite recently. I think you more recently than me. I'm just ready to get into it. Will Ashton, are you?
Why not? Let's do it.
Let's do it. So on today's episode of Cinemaholics, we are diving into A Real Pain. This is Jesse Eisenberg's latest directorial effort, where he stars alongside Kieran Culkin. The film follows two American Jewish cousins, David and Benji, who could not be more different. David is the reserved family man, while Benji is the quintessential free spirit. They head to Poland to explore their late grandmother's heritage, and things take a turn when they join a Holocaust tour. It's not just about the journey, though. It's about the tension between these two personalities and how they confront generational trauma, family history, and their own identities. Eisenberg weaves humor and depth into this story, making it a fascinating look at how the past shapes us, especially when it comes to family. So, Will, let's unpack these themes. Let's see what we have to say. This is a little bit of an excerpt from the review that I did not publish of the movie because I got a little bit busy. But this was essentially how I was going to frame the film, and I stand by it. I know, Will, I think we both watched Jesse Eisenberg's first film. I know I did. When you finished Saving the World?
Yeah, the Sundance one. Yeah.
It was a Sundance film. He did not star in it. This time he is starring in the film. That film starred Julianne Moore and Finn Wolfhard, and it was also based on an Audible original that he did back in 2020 as a playwright. And so this really is like totally kind of different efforts in that sense. Like, it felt like when you finished Saving the World, not a movie I liked at all, quite honestly.
Oh, really? I thought it was all right. I remember thinking it was fine.
I the problem with that movie for me, and not to belabor it, I suppose, is that I just think the Finn Wolfhard character and performance just did not work. And the Julianne Moore performance was just fine. So I just came out of it really not liking the writing or a lot of the acting. But A Real Pain is a real departure from that kind of format, at least for me. This film, I was really, really pleasantly surprised by. I think the number one thing that surprised me by it was going into it. I mean, from the get-go, the film is constantly trying to subvert your expectations for the kind of award season, odd couple, road trip movie that we typically see. And it does that by kind of setting up Eisenberg as like the typical straight man character. But then Benji is this character who I think is very, very different from what I expected based on the setup. And that's where I was immediately hooked. But what did you think?
Yeah, I mean, for me, you know, I'm glad you brought up the first film he did when he finished Saving the World. Because, like, you know, I don't think that's a perfect film, but I do remember enjoying it maybe a little bit more than you and other people, because it is a kind of brazen, prickly debut. Like, it's something that he's trying to kind of harken back to, like, his relationship to Noah Baumbach, and like kind of doing something that feels confident but also not quite accessible to a broader or a mainstream audience. This is
a bit of a Terra lift, if you will.
Sure. But this one, obviously, I think is going for that kind of commercial appeal, which is a weird thing to say about a movie about two cousins just going on a tour of a Holocaust, you know, concentration camp and yeah. sort of thing. But I do think that this movie, it reminds me in a good way and in a nostalgic way of the type of like character-driven, actor-driven, Sundance-y dramedies that I would consume a bunch in like high school. Like the types of films that like came out a lot in like the late 2000s and early 2010s, you know, like the type of movies that, you know, when they premiere at Sundance, like this one did, they get like a whatever, you know, like crazy number amount of money, like $15 million acquisition from Focus Features, or in this case, Searchlight Pictures. And, you know, they go for the awards thing and they tend to, you know, kind of make a big splash, or they just don't make a splash at all. Sometimes that happens with these Sundance-y movies. But in this case, yeah, I think there is something kind of comforting about this movie being fairly low stakes, something that is, like we said, centralized to these two characters, kind of coming to terms with their sort of dysfunctional relationship. I like that it's mature, but doesn't feel like it's like trying to get into like the deeper, messy aspects of their lives. I think you're going to probably disagree with that, but I do like that it is a fairly contained, you know, well-focused film that, you know, like I said, kind of just reminds me of those type of films that, like, it makes you feel like when you're a kid, like you're watching a really adult thing, even if it doesn't, you know, it's not like deeply, deeply serious or something that is deeply, deeply complex, but it does feel like, oh, like when you're a young person, you're kind of watching like the mature, you know, movies for adults sort of thing, because they're cussing and talking about life and sex and all these mature things and smoking weed and all this. And yeah, I mean, I think for me, though, beyond that kind of nostalgic factor, I think what really works for me primarily is the Kieran Culkin relationship and the way.
Yes, the performance.
That, yeah. And the way that Eisenberg is, I think, kind of doing some sort of like self-evaluation or maybe even a career sort of evaluation with these two characters. Like, I think casting himself as the like co-lead of the film is not an incidental thing. Like, I think the fact that he is ostensibly, or at least on the onset, kind of playing, you know, your sort of typical Ben, or not Ben, Jesse Eisenberg sort of character, you know, neurotic, kind of high strung, you know, like kind of overcompensating by talking too much sort of thing that like we kind of associate with, you know, he kind of got typecast into. And then we have Kieran Culkin, who is kind of both like the other type of character that Jesse Eisenberg sort of plays, but also what I kind of imagine he wants to kind of be like, and sometimes like a little bit more socially confident, a little bit more self-secure, someone who isn't really afraid of being, you know, like so self-contained. And I do like that it seems like Jesse Eisenberg, when he is acting these days and not focused on writing and directing, he is taking some kind of big swings and doing, I think, some really interesting stuff. Like, I haven't seen, what was it, Sasquatch Nation, or what was the one that he did where he was, that was also at Sundance this year.
Sasquatch Nation, you said?
Or what was it called?
Sasquatch Sunset.
That's it. Sasquatch Sunset.
Produced that. He didn't direct it, though.
No, but he's in it. He's a star. Yeah. But I'm saying,
were talking about like his effort, like as a director or writer.
No. I mean, as an actor, I think he's actually doing some interesting things like that, and the artist self-defense. Gotcha. Even to some extent, like him playing a kind of Elon Musk-y, Mark Zuckerberg-esque version of Lex Luthor, I think is better than people give him credit for. I don't know. I think he is pushing himself as an actor, and in this movie, I think it's kind of him as director, maybe taking a more kind of comfortable stance compared to his first movie, but as an actor and a writer, kind of maybe challenging himself and his screen persona a little bit more. So overall, I like this. That's a kind of long-winded way of saying that I think it's an interesting film for him at this point in his career, and I think as a more kind of commercial effort, it's a fun little dramedy.
Yeah, I mean, I like this movie a lot too. So I would say this is definitely one of my favorites of the year so far. And, you know, I'll try to walk through, because you covered a lot. So I'll start with the Jesse Eisenberg performance. I'd say that, you know, I agree with you. I've always found him to be somebody who a lot of people underestimate sometimes, or they kind of, like you said, they typecast him, or they kind of put him in this box of like, oh, he's that kind of neurotic, you know, geeky actor guy. But then I feel like some of the movies he's done, like The End of the Tour as well, and The Art of Self-Defense, have shown that he is like, just like when he's on it, like he can really put in a very complicated, layered performance. And he just clearly has like a real sense of the screen and how things kind of come together, which I feel like even with When You Finish Saving the World, which I didn't really like that much, as we mentioned, I just think that at the same time, I mean, he clearly just has a knack for, like, he understands where things should be. Like, he understands, like, staging very well and pacing and how to kind of, like, make his stamp. So I've really for a long time felt like he is well suited to directing and writing and has shown that already. And I think this movie really cements him as, like, okay, yeah, he's a serious director. But honestly, I think the movie really comes through with Kieran Culkin. Because, and I think by design, I think the whole point of the movie is the Kieran Culkin performance balancing against Jesse Eisenberg, sort of like, it's like the Jesse Eisenberg actor and character in this is a lot like the one we see in the movies. And I think, I'm so glad you mentioned that the Kieran Culkin version of him in this really feels like the identity he almost like holds back from, or it's like the identity he wishes he could embrace, but he medicates away from himself. And there are just so many nice little touches in the movie that kind of stress that point. And you can really, you can read this movie in a lot of different valid ways. And one of them is the kind of like, you know, the person you sort of were, the person you are now, the tension between those two things, trying to find the middle ground. And I think where this movie kept surprising me is in how it found actual humor in that stuff. Even when you juxtapose it against the Holocaust and you have all these scenes where Benji will have like a public meltdown. Based on like these little tensions that you can almost like, it's like you're reading Jesse Eisenberg's thoughts, you know, the kind of stuff he's probably thinking all the time, but doesn't say out loud. But I think it was Andrew Garfield who said like, that's the beauty of art because it allows us to access places where we couldn't go otherwise. And that's really like what this kind of movie, I honestly think does.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, and one of the main reasons I wanted to discuss it on this show is like, I think on a personal level, there's something really kind of gratifying about that as someone who's been like on the spectrum for, you know, obviously my whole life. But, you know, like there's this, I think idea when you're on the spectrum that like you're not supposed to have like meltdowns. You're not supposed to kind of like show your emotions. You're kind of supposed to, there's a perception, I think, when you're, you know, like on the spectrum that you're like, you're not supposed to act out. You're not supposed to do these sort of things. You're kind of supposed to fit in line with, you know, social standards. And I don't know necessarily that that's what Jesse Eisenberg was going for. I don't think that's like the intent of the film or anything. But on a personal level, I felt really that was something I really responded to with Benji and with Jesse Eisenberg's character. Was it Danny or not? Or I forget exactly what his
David. Character. David and it. Benji. Yeah.
I knew it was like David or Danny. I couldn't remember exactly. I knew the duh. I just couldn't remember. Yeah.
Yeah. Duh is right. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Duh. Yeah. Yeah. But no, I mean, I think that was something that, you know, it was really touching and I felt like it was tackling that sort of kind of complicated idea in a way that was like, you know, accessible to a broad audience, but touching on something that was very real and honest for me and something I find myself kind of grappling with on a day to day kind of basis. You know, this idea of like you have to kind of shelter a part of yourself to feel like you're functioning in society and the idea of like someone like Benji, you know, feeling like he can be himself, but at the same time, not really being comfortable with who he is, but not feeling like he can show that side of himself is a really kind of fascinating dynamic that I think Kieran Culkin explores really well with his performance.
Yeah, this is, some people have said this is a career defining performance for Culkin, especially coming off of Succession, which truly, you know, elevated his profile, I think fittingly so. And I always felt like while I was watching Succession that Culkin really was the heavy hitter in that show for me. I just always felt like whenever he was on screen, the show was like at its best for me, just because I think that his character was just one of the better written ones. I think that he just had such a presence and such a grappling with the material that made everything electric. But I think one of the reasons the show works the way it does is because he's not the main character. It's more sort of like he hovers over the whole thing because he's not the main character. It kind of fits the entire setup for that show.
I feel like I felt that way with Matthew McFadden more than
sure. I mean, I can buy that. I mean, yeah.
But I mean, I think that last season of Succession is the best season in no small part because Kieran Culkin really gets to like come alive with his performance. And I think he is excellent in that last season. I feel like this really does feel like a good successor, no pun intended, to what he was doing on that show in that last season.
It's the Kierannaissance we're in right now, you know, from Home Alone to this. He's really come his way. Although we of course have our soft spot for Scott Pilgrim versus the World. And yeah, he did. He voiced the reprisal of his character in Scott Pilgrim Takes Off last year, which was a great show. And anyway, you mentioned how this movie has a bit of commercial appeal. And I think that's true. I don't think that that's a knock against the movie in case somebody misheard. But the idea is that I think this is the kind of film that it appeals to people because the way it's an easy pitch, I think, for people to kind of wrap their heads around. And it's been proving out. So, you know, it hit limited release in early November, I think November 1st. It opened in just a few theaters, but it kind of raised some eyebrows because its per theater average was $60,000. So it's among one of the top performers of the year in that per theater average. And then a few weeks later, so like pretty recently, it started to expand more. It's in over 1,000 theaters right now. It's made about $5 million domestically, $6 million worldwide. So it's, I think, a good success at this point because, yeah, that's not a lot of money, but this is a pretty low budget film, about $7 million, and they haven't, I don't think that they've been breaking the bank to market it. And I think with award season still kind of picking up, it's only, I think, going to collect more cash, as it were. So I think this is a success story in the making, not just with the box office, but of course the critical acclaim, which we'll do in the Rotten Tomatoes game. But I'm sure you have a sense that people are liking the movie.
Yeah, I mean, and again, when I talk about the commercial appeal of the film, I just juxtaposition that with his first film, which I think it was intentionally sort of abrasive and prickly. And, you know, I think that movie was not trying to gear itself towards a wider audience in a way that I think this movie is deliberately kind of being more accessible to a broader audience, in spite of the fact that if you were to just say like it's about two cousins taking a tour of a concentration camp, that doesn't sound
but it's
like,
funny,
right? Yeah, but yeah. Then, you know, like I mean I only say that because like you say, like the pitch might be more easier, it might be an easier sell, but I think you'd have to kind of do a little bit of justifying, because that sentence I don't think really would sell people on its own.
I think part of the pitch is like who's in it. I think they know both of these actors. People right. generally are interested in seeing these actors do their thing. And yeah, I think like the idea of like, oh, two very different kinds of people on a very interesting kind of historical road trip that kind of blends. It's like a dramedy. I think that's easy for, like, compared to when you finish Saving the World, it's a lot harder to describe that movie to somebody. It's like, it's a Sundance movie. This kid, he's sure. really annoying. And his mom is kind of nice. Like it's a little bit trickier, but I see your point. Now you also mentioned some of the influences you think this movie maybe is borrowing from. You mentioned Noah Baumbach. I was definitely thinking Meyerowitz Stories while I was watching.
Well, I was thinking more with his first movie was Noah Baumbach. Yes, but I get what you're saying. Yeah, with this movie probably. Well,
I was going to go back in time as well, but I guess I was thinking of Meyerowitz just because that movie also is about like really complicated family dynamics and generational baggage, and also how it is kind of funny, but it also is like, all right, here's a little bit of a serious moment, but then here's the humorous stuff too. The other movie though, because you mentioned movies that like you kind of grew up on, later ones, like I thought of maybe like there's a little bit of like A Serious Man that I was kind of like that kind of hit my head when you mentioned that, just because like I think that that's a pretty dark comedy about, you know, the existential crisis of a Jewish man, you know, and there's a little bit of absurdity there too. But also, I don't know, I think that Lost Translation would probably be the movie like a little bit more like when I was kind of growing up and like when I was watching a movie and being like, this is for adults, but I didn't realize, you know, that it was a bit more accessible than I was giving it credit for, I suppose. I don't know if that's fair.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the type of movie I think of in my head when I'm thinking about that is like Cedar Rapids, or like it's kind of a funny story. I'm not saying that those movies are comparable to this one, but that's kind of like the tone I'm thinking of in that respect, because I think those are both Sundance movies as well. But yeah, I mean, I think I don't know, the A Serious Man seems like a bit of a leap. I love that movie immensely. It's probably my top 50 favorite movies of all time. I can vaguely kind of see what you mean by that, but I think that's definitely a more surrealist, kind of more abrasive film than what this is going for. But
I'll say, because you know, I don't think it's a direct comparison, but I do think that it's clear to me Eisenberg is heavily influenced by Woody Allen, and I think you can draw a straight line between Annie Hall and this movie. Just because I do think that like the kind of stuff that Woody Allen was doing, and you know, this is not a Woody Allen fan club over here on a personal level, but artistically what he was doing with that movie in Manhattan and all those was kind of showing like the sort of Jewish man kind of having like this anxiety crisis, this generational crisis about where they fit in the world. And I think, I mean, Eisenberg was in a Woody Allen movie at one point.
Yeah.
And so I have to say, like, I think that that's probably the kind of material he's thinking about when he is trying to bring himself into pieces of art. So I don't know if that's a stretch, but it hit me.
No, I get what you're saying. I mean, obviously, you know, Woody Allen plays characters in his movies, but they also are kind of supposed to be self-surrogates and people that kind of fit into like his sort of neurotic bag. And I think that that's kind of meant to be the case with this movie as well. Like I said, I mean, I think there's a little bit more at play with that. I think there's a little bit more on Jesse Eisenberg's mind. Like, I don't think he's just like, quote unquote, playing himself in this movie. But, you know, I think there is a lot of interesting pseudo commentary here. It does kind of feel like we're almost sitting in on like a therapy session for Jesse Eisenberg at times. And like there are like two, you know, two people in his head kind of self-evaluating at times, I feel like. But again, maybe that's a little too presumptuous. I don't really know him as a person. I don't know. Maybe that's all.
Not yet.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, maybe
we'll
one day.
On the show.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. The only thing I really want to highlight outside of that I feel like should be celebrated is that this is produced by Emma Stone and her husband, Dave McCary. McCary?
McCary,
yeah. He's the director of Bigsby Bear. And I think as producers, they've been really doing some top-notch work this year. They also produced one of my favorite movies of the year. I saw a TV Glow, and it seems like they're just kind of, you know, championing a lot of interesting projects as producers with their production company. And yeah, I think that's really cool.
Yeah, I agree. And I also wanted to highlight, I think one of my favorite scenes from this movie is the concentration camp scene, which feels like a weird sentence, but it's true. And I think it's just because I just really like how understated it ends up being, you know, like it's sort of about how awkward that kind of visit is, like to be a tourist in that kind of situation. It's something that I think a lot of people might shrug off for the sake of like not wanting to think about it. But I think the way Eisenberg kind of handles it in terms of like not really using any like music, nothing flashy here, just letting the silence kind of be the thing, and then having to decompress right afterward. I think that he deserves some credit for going in that direction with it, because it really does match the tone of the movie. And also, I don't want to give anything away, obviously, but the ending of the movie really had me thinking a lot about what was really going on in certain ways. And I think that there are a lot of complex takeaways you could have from what the ending kind of means in an abstract level. And I just had some fun, like thinking to myself about it, being like, huh, I wonder, you know, what would be the most absurd, you know, takeaway from this? And that's kind of where I landed. I wish we could talk about it without spoiling the actual movie, but I wasn't sure if you had similar thoughts.
No, I mean, I'll probably try to talk around it, but I think the movie is really effective about, like, you know, not using flashbacks or like not trying to, you know,
doesn't need to.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I liked how much the movie is about the present and kind of living in the moment, even though it's characters reckoning with their past and like kind of coming to terms with like some like, you know, dysfunctional things that relate to their background and stuff like that. I do really appreciate how the movie uses location to kind of explore the inner workings or the lack thereof, the lack of self-evaluation with their characters. And yeah, the beginning of the movie, like having Kieran Culkin just kind of be at the airport extra early, having the idea of it being established that like he is a sort of extroverted personality that can't really find any sense of calm with like a sense of like foundation or like any sense of like normalcy in a way that you're not like kind of beating it over the head. You're just kind of showing like a little piece of his life. I think it's some really effective acting and directing on Kieran's part for the acting and directing on Eisenberg's part.
Yeah, I think that's what I love about the beginning of the movie, like actually love, because it sets it up for you to be like, oh, okay, this guy's going to be a burnout. He's going to be a thorn in Eisenberg's side. He's going to be late and he's not answering his phone. But it's like, no, he was there early. And yeah, he is this kind of extroverted guy. He really cares about people. He wants to get to know people. But then you start to see the dark side of that, the side of him that tends to be a little self-righteous, a little problematic in certain ways, a little difficult to deal with. And I think that complexity is what makes him lovable as a character. It's what makes him memorable too. Like there aren't a lot of characters like him. You know, I can definitely see the sketch of like the Eisenberg character in a lot of different things, but that's really the point. He's trying to be normal. He's trying to be familiar and to get along, to go along. And Benji is more sort of this force of nature that he just, you know, he you know, he has a whole monologue about at a certain point in the movie in terms of his complicated, you know, acceptance or lack of in terms of Benji as a character. Yeah, and that's where I think the movie really hits its stride. Now, there have been some criticisms toward the movie that I want to cover real quick before we get into the Rotten Tomatoes game, at least. But Richard Brody didn't really like the movie. He said that the themes, like its exploration of themes, was superficial. So he kind of suggests that a lot of the dialogue, a lot of the drama, it's overdone, a little bit surface level, doesn't have a lot of depth thematically. And yeah, you know, I just think that this is one of those cases where what you read as superficial, I think I read as, oh, it's being subtle and it's not, you know, it's not saying all of the different layers and thematic resonance. It's just letting it hit you in a certain way. So I could see how maybe some people that might come off as superficial, but I can't say I agree.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're probably, you know, you have a deeper relationship to this movie than I do. I would not call it superficial. I would not call it, you know, empty. I can see what he means, though, where it's like, it is very written. I think Eisenberg at the moment, you know, as I think he is coming into his own as a director, but there are a couple moments in this film where I really did feel like, okay, like he is, you know, really telling as opposed to showing here. And I think he'll get more comfortable by getting away from that. But it is a sophomore film, and I kind of feel that at times. So I can kind of get where Brody's coming from in some respects.
Yeah, I guess my counter to that is I felt like when the movie was about to do too much of that, I would give it credit for holding back. I think that there were a couple of times when there was about to be the big speech, but instead, like, the scene ends, or it was a little bit more true to life in some respects. But yeah, there are some scenes where they really go for it in terms of the dialogue, but I still felt like it was so tightly written that, yeah, it definitely satisfied me, but, you know, it's not going to satisfy everybody, that's for sure. Should we play the Rotten Tomatoes game?
Sure. I thought you were going to label or, you know, throw some more criticisms, but I guess you're just trying to take
that. No, that was the main thing. I didn't really see a lot, but I did a cursory search of the internet for that. But yeah, no, let's take a look at the Rotten Tomatoes and then see what our friends have to say about the movie to get the full perspective. All right. So a real pain. It's, let's see here. We have 184 reviews from critics counted. Will, what's your guess on the percentage right now?
I think critics are saying that A Real Pain is a real good time at the movies because they're going to give it, I'm going to guess, 87%.
Ooh, quite a bit higher. I'll give you one more guess.
Oh, too high. Okay, that's interesting.
No, I'm saying it is higher than what you guessed.
Oh, okay. So they are really saying that it's a real good time at the movies.
Maybe they're saying it's a really good time.
Yeah. Yeah, not real, just really. Yeah, I'm going to say 94% then.
Almost. You got pretty close. 96%. So even higher than that. Yeah. This is a bit of a critic pleaser, that's for sure. But let's take a look at the audience score / popcorn meter, as they call it. We have 500 plus verified ratings. What do you think?
I think, you know, I think audiences generally are going to like it. Like I say, I think it is a film that is appealing. Like, I think it's an easy watch, all things considered. You know, I mean, as far as movies about people going to concentration camps go, I think this is a pretty easy watch. You can put that on the poster if you want.
Wow.
Yeah. But anyway, no, I think this one, like you said, I think it's more of a critical favorite than probably an audience favorite, just because, I don't know, not to be too judgmental or anything, but like, I can kind of see some audience members being like, oh, is that it? Like, oh, it's just like two cousins, you know, reuniting and getting and talking their troubles out. I can see like some people maybe expecting something bigger, more bombastic or something by the end. Like you said, maybe it might play a little too subtle for maybe a broader audience. So I'm going to say this is probably like a 76% on that, whatever you call it, popcorn meter or popcorn.
Yeah.
Everything.
Popcorn can trash. It's a little bit higher than 76, but not by much. It's 81% right now. So not too bad. Not too bad for an audience score. But yeah, I think you're right on the money overall in terms of how the audiences are taken away from this so far. We don't have a cinema score for this one, so we'll jump right into Letterboxd. Before we see what our friends on Letterboxd have to say about the movie, what about the average rating? Because we have 76,000 watches logged. Not a ton, but it's probably going to be crawling up over the next month or so. What do you think the average rating on Letterboxd is from 0 to 5?
I think most people, I don't know, I just, the vibe I get it's that most people are going to give this like a 3.5 out of 5. Like, good movie. You know, nothing that's going to like rock my socks off. I think some people like you are going to be really responding to it and really liking it. And obviously there are going to be people that don't like it or maybe think it's mid or whatever. But I feel like 3.6 is a comfortable guess.
Very, very close. Only a little bit off. It's 3.8. And but it'll probably go down a little bit more. I have a feeling that it'll probably maybe tick down to 3.6 eventually based on just some of the overall trends we're seeing. It's usually how it turns out, right? Okay, yeah. In terms of friends of the show, former co-host of Cinemaholics and a best friend of the show, well, we want to call her Abby Olchesi. She's probably a little bit closer to your world here or your take, about 3.5 stars. And Abby wrote, like a millennial Jewish with Nail and I, and the dynamic between its two main characters, the occasional antics, and the deep sadness that dynamic masks.
Yeah, I mean, I would love to have Abby on to promote her book at one point. I asked for it in my Christmas list, I meant to tell you. Yeah.
Well, you have to ask. So maybe Santa will show up on Cinemaholics and, you know, if only we had time to have him on right this second. But, you know, we can't delay, you know, our friends of the show who want to get their thoughts out. Here we go. Ryan Oliver, friend of the show, gave it 4 stars. So about where I'm at with the movie. And he said, I kept waiting for the farcical version of this odd couple setup that we've seen dozens of times to creep in, or for it to go big and broad, as many grief-stricken dramedies tend to do, and shockingly, neither happened. It's a tribute to the excellent tightrope that Eisenberg walks here that a real pain works so well as it does. The history that Eisenberg and Culkin effortlessly embody with their bodies and facial expressions, making us believe that they really are cousins or close to brothers, as Benji refers them as, is some of the best acting I've seen this year, a really special movie. Yeah, I'm pretty much exactly where Ryan Oliver is with that. I agree with every word.
Cool, cool.
Another friend of the show, Aaron Dicer, also gave it 4 stars. He wrote, a vividly powerful story about the nuances and subtleties of mental health and its relationship to community. Sometimes the grass isn't greener. It's just impacted by shadows and light. Yeah, you know, I got to say, I think that in terms of like the mental health stuff, maybe that is one thing I kind of wish the movie would have been a little bit more forthcoming about. I do think that it buries the lead a little bit with how mental health stuff really factors in, but it's not a huge complaint or anything, because I do think that's also kind of what I like about the movie, is that it doesn't overspell that sort of stuff. So maybe I'm a little conflicted on it, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if there's anything that I feel maybe not superficial, but maybe I feel like could have been, you know, a little bit pricklier given Eisenberg's style in his previous movie, or maybe something that was like a little bit more upfront. I think it could have been the mental health aspects, but I don't know. I don't think it handles it poorly or anything, or tastelessly or anything of that note. I feel like there's a little bit more room for exploration, but I also, like you were kind of alluding to, like that we're not like supposed to get like a full, you know, picture of these characters. We're just kind of getting a slice of life of them, and you know, we're just kind of getting a brief window into their lives, and so I think that's appropriate.
Yeah, yeah. We're not getting a diagnosis. We don't need that. Allison Johnson, friend of the show, gave the movie 4 stars, but no written review here. Robert Yanez Jr., no stars or review, but gave it a nice little heart. And the heart speaks volumes, if you ask me. Friend of the show, Corey Everett, did not like the movie very much, it seems, gave it 2.5 stars. And Corey wrote, Culkin colors outside the lines and Eisenberg's nicely directed, but somewhat predictable Sundance indie dramedy. Planes, Trains, and Holocaust Museums, or the Darjeeling Limited. I'm sorry. Wow. Well, Corey, I love you, Corey, but I'm going to give your puns 2.5 stars.
Okay. No, I got some chuckles out of those.
Just the second one. The first one I'm okay with, but to be totally honest. Friend of the show, Isaac Feldberg, gave it 3.5 stars, so a little bit closer to you, Will. And he wrote, I spoke to Jesse Eisenberg about personal stories and conversations with history, Holocaust tourism, what his film has to say about the ambivalence of homecoming. And but oh, he didn't link to it. I want to read this, Isaac. So if you ever listen to this, I would love to see more of how that conversation turned out. A friend of the show, Kristen Lopez, also did not seem to like the movie very much at all. She only gave it 2 stars. No review, though.
I mean, you know, she beats her own heart. I feel like just kind of getting the occasional glimpse at her letterbox reactions, you know, that she, you know, sometimes loves the movie, sometimes she hates it, doesn't always follow in line with the public consensus, and I have to respect that.
Same here. Yeah, she can be a Benji, you know, in terms of like, you never know what's going to happen. Kimber Myers, friend of the show, gave the movie 4.5 stars and a heart. Kimber Myers really liked this one, and I'm happy to see that. Friend of the show, Corey Woodruff, he did write a review. He wrote 2 reviews. So he saw this back in January. So this is his January review for Sundance. He said, Jesse Eisenberg, sophomore, is a tidal wave of messy grace as a real pain studies the uncontrollable sorrow of unpacked trauma against the backdrop of strained relationships with those you love and those you barely know. Eisenberg and Kieran Culkin are both magnificent as a pair of mismatched cousins venturing to Poland to walk in the footsteps of their late grandmother, a Holocaust survivor. The two have their own tensions to settle, and we all know how strange life can get when you leave the confines of your home for a lengthy trip abroad. Rather than let the film wallow in a sense of self-pity, Eisenberg shrewdly lets the pains of the setting and the underlying dynamics of its leads guide the emotion while finding bits and bobs of matter-of-fact humor in the journey. Only 2 films in, Eisenberg is already showing himself to be wildly capable, sojourner of the fraught human condition, one that leaves you laughing one moment and bawling your eyes out the next. A Real Pain is a stellar example of compact, humane storytelling, free from frills, and dedicated to finding the right answers, even when they're fractured and frazzled. That's that Corey Woodruff. I gotta say, he loves to can spin a yarn. I'll tell you that much.
Absolutely, yeah. I do. I was chuckling to myself though, because like, free from frills. I don't know. In my mind, just I imagine him saying, but filled with chills, and just turning into like a Halloween review.
He had a second review he wrote when he rewatched the movie just a couple of weeks ago here. And he wrote, there are so many ways this could have gone wrong, but Eisenberg lets these guys be real. These are real people, real scenarios, real transfixing contradictions for your problematic loved ones, if you can even call them that. It's really hard to love people that embarrass you, and it's even harder when you will forever justify the embarrassment because you love them. One of the best this year, and even better in a theater. I wish I could have seen this in a theater. I'm kind of bummed I didn't, but I'm glad I did get to see the movie at all. I'll tell you that.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say... You were telling me before we recorded that you've been watching movies on your, what do you call it?
The Vision Pro.
The Vision Pro.
It's and like I feel, the big screen.
Sure. But I just think it's so funny to imagine, you know, like I in my head canon, you watching movies on the Vision Pro is like those like ads before a movie at AMC where the audience member is like throwing popcorn because they're like so excited and all this stuff. But yeah. Like it's just you just calmly hands folded just watching this movie. Just you,
yeah,
just
try to sip my beverage, but I can't find it.
Right. But you just like getting like this 4D experience of people just quietly walking through a concentration camp with your Vision Pro.
Man, friend of the show, Emma Sasek, gave it 3.5 stars. And she wrote, it's really exciting to see Kieran Culkin and Jesse Eisenberg clash and find their way together in A Real Pain. A much stronger and more mature film compared to Eisenberg's first, as it centers itself on this complex relationship between two cousins. Culkin shows a lot of different moods and emotions here, always keeping you on your toes and how he'll respond to any situation, while Eisenberg is much more restrained, but still wonderful as he navigates this tense, week-long trip. A pleasant surprise. And to be clear, Emma also wrote about the film back in January. And then lastly, we have, well, not lastly, because we do have Alex Billington, another friend of the show, gave it 4.5 stars and a heart. And Amanda the Jedi also wrote, well, wrote one word. It's the F word. And I also gave the movie a heart and 4 stars. So that's what our friends had to say about A Real Pain. If you're listening to this as we like close to when we're recording it, it should still be playing in some theaters near you and might be worth the trip for you. But with that, we'll say goodbye for now. Thanks so much for listening to Cinemaholics. Be sure to subscribe to us on your favorite podcast app if you're not already. And of course, you can always join the In Between Drafts Discord where you can get Cinemaholics episodes right into a Discord server. You can chat with me whenever you want. Will doesn't come onto the Discord unless I tell him someone's talking about him, and then he'll
Yeah.
But with that, we'll see you on the next episode. From the Internet, California, I'm John Negroni.
And from the Internet, Pennsylvania, I'm Will Ashton.
See you next time.